Welcome to WhiskyCast, Cask Strength Conversation, featuring news and interviews from the world of whiskey. I'm Mark Gillespie. This is episode number 769 for May 26th, 2019. Coming up in a few minutes.
There are, of course, always going to be people who will not want to hear it, who will say that the only way you can do something is the traditional way of doing things, which I think is really ironic because whiskey was once made through very rebellious means. And the whole history of whiskey is largely one of repeated rebellion after rebellion after rebellion.
Technology is being used to disrupt the traditional way of making whiskeys through so-called accelerated maturation techniques. And the next step on that path is already here, replicating the flavor and aroma characteristics of whiskey in a lab, then adding them to grain-neutral spirits and a small amount of whiskey straight off the still. The result? A so-called spirit whiskey that never touches a barrel. Alec Lee is one of the founders of Endless West, a San Francisco tech company that has produced what it calls the first molecular whiskey, Glyph. It's sold right alongside traditionally distilled whiskeys at retailers in California and New York. And I'll discuss it with Alec Lee later on WhiskyCast In-Depth. That's just ahead, along with the calendar of events, your voice, and much more. It's all coming up on this edition of WhiskyCast.
WhiskyCast, brought to you by Redbreast, the definitive single pot still Irish whiskey. Those in the know Redbreast.
From far beyond the wall comes a whiskey for those who face the oncoming storm and never stop walking. Winter is here. White Walker by Johnny Walker.
White Walker by Johnny Walker. Blended Scotch whiskey, 41.7% alcohol by volume. Imported by Diageo North America, Norwalk, Connecticut. Please drink responsibly.
Let's get started with the news. It's brought to you by Heaven Hill Distillery. And we'll update the story we brought you last time around on the tariff battle over bourbons and other American whiskeys. As expected, Canada and Mexico have both removed their tariffs on U.S.-made whiskeys that were imposed last July. Those punitive tariffs were intended to retaliate for U.S. tariffs on steel and aluminum imports from those countries. And an agreement late last week on steel and aluminum trade cleared the way for the whiskey tariffs to be removed. Mexico had been hitting U.S.-made whiskeys with a 25% tariff, while Canada was imposing a 10% tariff. Punitive tariffs on U.S. whiskeys are still in effect in the European Union, China, and Turkey because of the ongoing dispute over steel and aluminum trade. Scotch whiskey industry leaders gathered in Edinburgh this week for the Scotch Whiskey Association's annual conference. With the Brexit debate still clearly uncertain, SWA Chief Executive Karen Betts called on governments to protect free trade. She called Scotch whiskey a textbook example of the benefits of free trade and says people worldwide can now buy a wider range of Scotch whiskies at more competitive prices. Turning now to new whiskies, the Balvenie has unveiled a new range of single malts. The Balvenie Stories lineup includes three new whiskies, and maltmaster David Stewart told me this week that the goal was to share some of the stories from the distillery.
There's quite a lot to be told about the actual whiskey itself and how it was created, and there's quite a lot to be told about the people at our distillery, like Ian McDonald and people in the maltings and mashing area, Kelsey, my apprentice, the maltmaster, and also myself that was involved in it as well. So the first one is it's a 12-year-old mark, and we bring in bourbon barrels from America to fill most of our whiskies into. And we work with, you probably know this cooperage, it's a Kelvin cooperage out in Kentucky that we bring in quite a lot of our cask from. So we asked them to bring in, you know, virgin oak, virgin white oak. And instead of getting these cast charred, we actually asked them just to give them a gentle toasting. So that's what they did to the, say, 100, 200 barrels. And then they sent them over to our cribbage in Scotland. And Ian McDonald there decided he wanted to just give them another short toasting. So another 20 minutes toasting. So he did that for each of the casks. And then we actually disgorged the Balvenie that had been aged in First World Bourbon barrels into a vat and filled that whiskey off into these toasted barrels. And at the end of the day, we left these casks in there for about 4 months. So it's another finish. Toasting opens up the wood a little bit and it releases this vanillin. So we've got increased the vanillin notes, vanilla notes, a slight oaky notes, but just more giving the whiskey a little bit more depth to it than maybe just the first four bourbon barrels give. So I'm quite delighted the way it's turned out to the mark. It's honeyed, it's vanilla, it's citrus, it's got maple syrup, brown sugar, all these lovely rich flavors and a delicate oakiness as well.
And then you brought the peat week into this range as well from the last couple of years with the new version, right?
That's it. Well, you know the peat week. That's it. We've been taking a week out in every year to make peated whiskey, which started in 2002. So you're right. We've done two editions of the peat week from 2002 and 2003. So this one's now called the Week of Peat. And this is really Ian Miller, when he was our distillery manager, deciding why don't we just take a week out each year and bring in peated barley and just distill with that barley for 1 week in the year. And we've been doing that every year since 2002. So we decided to bottle it at a 14 years age. And so this is called the Week of Peat. Yeah. So it's given us a delicate smokiness. It's peat from Speyside. It's coming from near Fraserburgh in the north of Scotland. So it's much more a delicate peat than you may get on Islay. So it's given the Balvenie a delicate smokiness. So it's still very much Balvenie. We've still got the honey and the vanilla and the citrus notes, but you've got this delicate smokiness in the background. And it's taking back to what we used to do going back into the 40s and 50s when most Speyside malts had that delicate smokiness to it.
The third whiskey is the 26-year-old Day of Dark Barley, which was distilled from heavily roasted malt back in 1992, and some of the casks were bottled in 2006 as the 14-year-old Balvenie Roasted Malt. That one will carry a recommended retail price of $799 a bottle, while the 12-year-old Sweet Toast of American Oak will sell for about $60 a bottle, and the Week of Peat will sell for around $99. It's Fagiel Week on Islay, and while the whiskey from Hunter Lang & Company's new Ardnahoe distillery will not be available for many years, Stewart Lang and his sons have created a new Islay single malt using their inventory of casks. The Scarabus Islay single malt takes its name from the Scarabus area of Islay and is making its debut this week during the festival. It'll go on sale in the UK and export markets starting in June with a recommended retail price of £38, or about $48 a bottle at current exchange rates. Highland Park has been working with Danish photographer Søren Sølker for the last several years to develop the brand's visual identity, and now the distillery is releasing a new 26-year-old bottling named for him. The Highland Park Søren Sølker 26 Years of Photography Edition will be available starting in June at select whiskey shops worldwide. There's no word on pricing. And while we'll be talking about a whiskey created in the laboratory later on during WhiskyCast In-Depth, Mac Mira will be releasing a new whiskey created with the help of machine learning. The Swedish distillery worked with Microsoft and Finnish tech company Fourkind to crunch years of data on distilling and sales to come up with some possible recipes. But McMirra master distiller Angela D'Orazio had the final say in creating the actual whiskey to be released later this year. In the U.S., Kansas City's Jay Rieger & Company has now set the grand opening date for its distillery expansion and new visitors center. It'll open on July 12th and will include two cocktail bars, along with a whiskey bottling station. You can keep up on the latest whiskey news all week long at WhiskyCast.com. The news is brought to you by Heaven Hill Distillery. Keeping American whiskey history and tradition alive isn't just a marketing slogan. It's part of Heaven Hill's fabric. When other distillers were getting out of the rye whiskey business, Heaven Hill saved the legendary Rittenhouse rye from becoming a footnote in the history books. Today it's the rye whiskey of choice, in a cocktail or neat, with a distinct spicy flavor all its own. Find out more at heavenhilldistillery.com. Think wisely, drink wisely. Time now for the Whiskey Cast calendar of events. Of course, the Islay Festival of Malt and Music continues all week long in Scotland and wraps up this coming Saturday with Ardbeg's Festival Day. Ardbeg is taking that festival day around the world with dozens of events on Saturday. And the fun starts on Thursday night with Ardbeg Day events in Detroit and Seattle. We have all of the details at the website. The Whiskey Extravaganza is in Los Angeles on Friday night, May 31st. And that same night is the Whiskey X in Chicago, along with the start of Whiskey Live all weekend long in Canberra, Australia. The Kentucky Bourbon Affair is June 4th through the 8th in Louisville, and the Bourbon Salon will be at Oxmoor Farm in Louisville on the 11th. Whiskies of the World is in Dallas, Texas, June 7th and 8th, and Whiskey Live Brisbane is June 14th and 15th in Brisbane, Australia. Finally, the Edinburgh Whiskey Festival is on June 15th in Edinburgh, Scotland. Right now, we have 234 different events on the searchable calendar at WhiskyCast.com. Just click on the search button to find events near you or wherever you'll be traveling soon. Grab a bourbon and settle into a good story. Heaven Hill's backroom stories, told by those who've rarely shared before, just how they shape the spirit and just how the spirit shapes them.
All the barrels are aging here. A lot of the airflow through the warehouse like this, you know, when you open a door, all that goodness hits you in the face. And, you know, it's something you never forget.
Download and listen to the new podcast, Tales from the Hill, from Heaven Hill Distillery. It's coming soon to Apple Podcasts, Google Podcasts, Spotify, and wherever you get your podcasts.
From deep in the north, far beyond the wall, the howl of the frozen wind brings word of something new. A whiskey from the land of always winter, for those who face the oncoming storm and never stop walking. Winter is here. White Walker by Johnny Walker.
White Walker by Johnny Walker. Blended Scotch Whiskey, 41.7% alcohol by volume. Imported by Diageo North America, Norwalk, Connecticut. Please drink responsibly.
Whiskey Cast In-Depth is brought to you by Mortlock. This time around, we're going to do the podcasting equivalent of walking up to a hive full of angry bees and whacking it with a golf club. We're going to talk about what could best be described as a synthetic whiskey created in a laboratory instead of a distillery. If you're a whiskey purist, your blood is probably boiling right now at the very thought. But there's a very good reason why we need to talk about it. You see, Glyph from San Francisco-based Endless West is already on the market. It's being sold alongside traditionally distilled and matured whiskeys at retailers in California and New York, and will go on sale in Michigan starting in June. Part of our mission here at WhiskeyCast is to provide education, and we think it's important that consumers know exactly what they're getting when they shop for whiskeys. In just a minute, I'll talk with Alec Lee, one of the co-founders of Endless West. He came up with the process for making Glyph. But first, let's explain just how Glyph is even legal in the first place, since whiskey is defined in U.S. regulations and elsewhere as an alcoholic distillate from a fermented mash of grain. You see, there's a separate definition in the regulations for so-called spirit whiskey. That's a mixture of neutral spirits and not less than 5% on a proof gallon basis of whiskey. And that's the category that Glyph fits into. The base is a blend of grain neutral spirits and a small amount of new make whiskey, to which flavors are added with a goal of making Glyph look, taste, and smell like whiskey. This past week, Glyph was featured at the Wall Street Journal's Future of Everything Festival in New York City, and that's where I caught up with Alec Lee. Let's start by talking about the need for a molecular whiskey like Glyph. How does this fit into the future of spirits, and why did you come up with the idea?
We get asked that question a lot. Why bother? Why should this exist? And I think it's a really interesting way of framing any whiskey in general, because I've never heard anyone ask that of any other whiskey, like, why should this exist? And so if we take a step back for a second, any whiskey exists in reality because someone decided that they wanted to make a new expression of something that meant, you know, something that was meaningful to them. And for us, the way that we think about this is whiskey as craft, or as whiskey as a form of art, is one way to simply express, you know, there's a traditional way of expressing that art form. And then there's a new way of also sort of thinking about what really makes whiskey whiskey, and can we make it from a completely different source of materials, but end up with the same thing. So for us, the analogy that we use a lot is electronic music. That we're not saying there's anything wrong with the traditional way of making whiskey or a traditional way of making music, but that some people want to hear a new story, right? Some people will still want to listen to violins and cellos and pianos and go to the symphony. And some people like want to go to a different kind of concert. And for us, that's what molecular spirits, and in this case, molecular whiskey is. It's a new way of expressing this traditional form of craft.
Tell me about your first experience drinking whiskey, the real stuff. If you're using that term loosely.
I feel like my first experience was very similar to most people's first experience. Well, actually, my very first experience with spirits in general was distilling brandy with my grandfather when I was a kid. He had a pot still in Eastern Europe, and you know, he had his own orchard, and he grew his own fruit and fermented it. And we made brandy together when I was 7 or 8 years old, and he would sort of, you know, discard the heads and capture the hearts and get rid of the tails, and he would save all of it for various like cleaning or medical uses, but of course save the hearts for drinking. And that, I think, was, you know, at the age of 8, a little bit too strong for any child. But thinking back on those experiences, you know, those are really meaningful memories to me. But as I grew older, I started to experience science with my dad, and also thinking about how can I bring all of these things together in some interesting new way that hasn't been done before. And that's ultimately kind of how we ended up here. It's an expression of something that means a lot to a lot of people, but it's a different way of thinking about it that, you know, science is also really meaningful to a lot of people too. And I think that we want to show, like, there is a creative capacity of science to express these things that are meaningful to people.
No arguments there. Clearly, there's a lot of science in the traditional whiskey-making process as well, but most of the listeners of our podcast are familiar with that process. They are not as familiar with your process, let's call it the electronic version of whiskey, using your analogy for electronic music versus analog music. Tell me about your process. How do you create this?
So we started a similar place, which is we need alcohol from somewhere. And of course, grain is a really efficient place to get alcohol from. So we actually start with water and a neutral grain spirit, as neutral and clean as possible. And that's sort of what we think of as a blank slate onto which we'll paint the rest of the whiskey. And the rest of it is really mapping the molecular profile of whiskeys out in the market. It's like being asked to paint a tree. If you haven't seen a tree before, you don't really know where to start. So we need to see many different photographs, many different scans of all different kinds of trees to understand what makes peaty, peaty, and what makes, you know, a weeded bourbon, what makes all these different flavor profiles uniquely themselves, how are they different, how are they similar. And once we understand the sense of, like, what makes a tree, then at a molecular level, we go back and we source each one of those individual molecules. And broadly, the reason why any of this works is because those molecules you can find in whiskey or wine or really any other food, they're really not unique to those beverages or those food products. There's a lot of cross-application of these molecules in other places in nature, which is why you might smell vanilla or caramel notes on whiskey. It's not a trick. It's literally the same molecule that you find in caramel or in vanilla. And the idea is there are much more efficient sources for any one of these specific molecules. You can go to that source, extract it completely pure, in much of the way that you would distill alcohol or purify alcohol out of beer or out of wine. You can purify these specific molecules and treat them like pigments of a paint. And then you can layer them onto each other one at a time. Hundreds and hundreds of molecules later, you end up with something that is, at a molecular level, whiskey, but was made overnight without any barrels, without any aging. Very much a design product, but not an analog. It's literally whiskey at a molecular level.
How did you assess these whiskeys? I'm assuming that this was all done in the laboratory, but how did you do it, and how many different whiskeys and how many different molecules did you have to go through to make this work?
Yeah, so the scanning and the design part really happens in our laboratory in San Francisco. And the way I sort of describe the technology is the main piece of equipment are effectively an electronic nose and then an electronic tongue. There's a little bit more to it than that, but that's roughly how it works.
Let's go ahead and use the technical terms here, because we have science nerds who are going to want to know about this, and they're not going to be satisfied with electronic nose, electronic tongue.
So the main workhorses are a gas chromatograph with a mass spectrometer and then a liquid chromatograph with a mass spectrometer. Again, there's a little bit more nuance to those things, but then we start getting into proprietary fun stuff. So those are the two main things, and each of those instruments will take any input off the shelf or our own for validation. It'll separate all those molecules by their physical properties, and it'll scan each one of them one at a time to give us the identity and give us the quantity of that. So we then have this digital scan, in our case, of a few hundred individual whiskeys that are out there, from all around the world, all different price points. And that sort of gives us a starting point to understand, if we want to make our own, what should it look like?
And you can design your own whiskey that way from the compounds you select, whether you want something peaty, sweet, woody, whatever, right?
Exactly.
And it's fair to say that the HPLCs, the liquid chromatographs, and the gas chromatographs and mass spectrometers are used in many whiskey laboratories now in traditional distilleries. They're doing these same studies and checking their barrels and doing the same kind of quality control work you're doing, so it's not far off.
It's not far off. It's the same sort of instruments. The way that I describe it is, if you want to get from point A to point B, you can use a bike, you can use a car, and there's many different kinds of cars. And some of them will do it a lot faster. Some of them will do it a lot more safely. And so, for the most part, what you find in food laboratories around the world is sufficient to do QA/QC. But once you actually need to do molecular reconstruction engineering, then you need a different set of equipment to do that job differently. And so, while the fundamental technology is the same, the use cases and the design of the equipment is ultimately pretty different.
Your process not only involves grain neutral spirits,
what civilians would refer to as baby vodka that hasn't quite been distilled yet. But you also have to use a certain amount of real whiskey or traditional whiskey as well, just because federal law in the U.S. dictates it, right?
That's right. So in order for us to get the spirit whiskey designation on our label, we needed to put in a minimum of 5% on a proof gallon basis of whiskey. What that is as neutral a whiskey as we could possibly find, but one that really ultimately just satisfies our labeling requirements more than anything else. You know, at 5% on a proof gallon basis is not really enough to get you a whiskey. So that really is, in practice, our blank canvas. Although, hopefully one day, the regulations will be a little bit more open to the kinds of things that we do, and so we'll be able to move away from that.
How on earth did you get the TTB to let this through when the standards of identity for whiskey in the regulations, as you note, the traditional style of whiskey, specifically says it's got to be distilled from a fermented mash of grain, and you're using the base elements of G&S and a little bit of whiskey and a lot of science here?
So it's an interesting question, because you said that whiskey has to be distilled from a mash, which this is. In our case, the GNS is distilled from mash, in this case, just simply corn. And it doesn't specify how many times you can or can't distill it, depending on, you know, the specific nuance, the specific type of whiskey that you're looking for. But at the end of the day, that is what meets the definition, although that's the spirit part of spirit whiskey. The whiskey part of it is that minimum of 5% on a proof gallon basis. So this is similar to how the TTB would think about, for example, White Dog, where it's mostly GNS with some unaged whiskey in it. But take it a couple steps further, and with the formulation, working with the TTB, of course, there's a lot of things that they wouldn't allow us to put on the label that we really wanted to. But we ended up in a place that I think both parties are satisfied that it is clear. It is pretty clear what it is when you look at the bottle and read it.
I'm going to argue one point with you. The term White Dog is not GNS. In whiskey, that's the new make spirit that comes straight off the still during the distilling process, the same as new make in Scotland. A White Dog is the term for it in a lot of U.S. distilleries. And I know that's essentially what you're using as the whiskey element in this, right?
They can add GNS if they wanted to, and it would still be spirit whiskey. That's all I'm saying. So there are products that are varying degrees of, or varying percentages of whiskey straight off the still. In our case, as low as possible, but of course the different market products have varying wages up to 100%.
But the term White Dog in traditional whiskey terms refers to brand new spirit, fresh off the still, that's been fermented, that's come through, that's been, basically it's the stuff that goes into the barrel, as far as a bourbon or a rye whiskey or a malt whiskey distiller would be concerned. That's what they're taking and putting straight into the barrel. It's not, there's no GNS in that as far as those guys are concerned, because they're not using GNS in bourbon or rye or malt whiskey.
Sure, that's fair.
How hard was it for you to explain this to the TTB, what you wanted to do? You mentioned that there were things they wouldn't let you put on the label. I'm assuming spirit whiskey with natural flavors was a compromise?
Well, we wanted molecular whiskey, but of course that's not a category. Perhaps one day it will be. But yeah, in some sense it was a compromise, but there's nothing more interesting to add there, unfortunately.
Could you, in theory, make a completely molecular whiskey, including the alcohol, or do you still need that base to paint on, as you say?
Well, if by base you mean with the whiskey straight off the still, the answer is no. It can be done straight with GNS, and that's how it was originally designed. It's only when we actually took it to scale up for production purposes that we added it in order to satisfy the labeling requirements.
Well, no, I'm talking about the future now. If the regulations didn't exist as they do now, could you, in theory, could this meat process be used to make a completely molecular whiskey with alcoholic content that does not rely on GNS or white dog fresh spirit off of a still? Could you create a whiskey, if the technical definition allowed for it, completely in the laboratory?
In theory, yes, although you'd still need to get the alcohol from somewhere. So it might not come from grain, it could come from cane instead, or from sugar beets, or really anything that makes a carbohydrate, anything that makes a starch or a sugar. So in theory, yes, but grain is, of course, a really efficient source. And so we're not necessarily saying that there's something uniquely valuable about not doing anything that remotely resembles traditional whiskey making process. What we're saying is it makes a lot of sense to go to the most efficient source for each one of those molecules. And it turns out that the ethanol molecule is largely most efficiently sourced from grain, in this case, corn specifically. And that's an interesting relic of agricultural subsidies and, you know, the United States sort of like agricultural system in general. But right now, it doesn't really make a lot of sense to go to other feedstocks for alcohol. But in theory, you could.
What's been the reaction from both within the, for using the lack of a better term, traditional whiskey industry and the consumers when you point out this to them and you take it to them and show them what you've done?
I think that if you hang around here at our booth long enough, you'll see that people are actually really excited about what it is. And we originally had a hypothesis that this was largely a techie focused kind of beverage. And that hasn't really panned out. And I think the reason is because we're not talking about it as the only reason why this is interesting is because of technology. The way that we're talking about it is, I think, very similar to how whiskey stories are traditionally told, which is as much about the rickhouse as they are about the people and the story, the human story behind them. And I think that it's really important to recognize that although technology is a really important fundamental tool that we use, the design of Glyph isn't made by machines. It's designed by people. There's a lot of people in, you know, in our lab and in our consumer testing and in our marketing team and just people that we've worked with who sit there and sort of talk through what they like and what they don't like, taste through hundreds of different versions, and really design these things from the ground up. And so it's still very much a human story, just looks very different than the traditional way. And so I think because of that, even in traditional whiskey drinking circles, a lot of people look at this and say, you know, it's interesting. Perhaps the flavor profile, depending on their preference, is or isn't for them. But they understand what we're doing. And as long as we're not trying to take away the traditional form of whiskey, which we're not, then they say, live and let live, right? That it's a new way to express this thing that I like, and so that's fine by me. There are, of course, always going to be people who will not want to hear it, who will say that the only way you can do something is the traditional way of doing things, which I think is really ironic because whiskey was once made through very rebellious means, and the whole history of whiskey is largely one of repeated rebellion after rebellion after rebellion. And so the notion that the thing that we did 20 years ago is the way that it should always be done is really laughable. And the notion that the way that we do things now in a very industrialized way is how we've always done it is also just not true. There's always a new way of doing things, and this, I think, is another way of doing things.
Let's talk about an issue that the industry is facing, sustainability. When you're talking bourbon barrels that can only be used once before they go on to their next purpose in Scotland or Ireland or for maturing Tabasco sauce or stuff like that, you're going through a lot of wood. We're going through a lot of grain and a lot of water to produce whiskey today. And we do have to realize that that does involve some resource issues that may affect us 50, 100 years down the road. Is this, in theory, a more sustainable way of making whiskey?
I think in theory it is. I really wouldn't call out the whiskey industry as being primarily challenging from a sustainability perspective. And the main reason for that is that corn is just a really, really efficient crop. And most of the white oak, the American white oak crops, are renewable. And so you're not really seeing primary deforestation. Those trees grow quickly enough, unlike a lot of Japanese oak, for example. And so although you do get a decent amount of waste, you know, you need very specific boards for the staves, and you have like very specific parameters, but there's some waste there. Compared to many other food making industries, it's really not that bad. So it is better for the environment to do it this way, and the primary reason isn't because we don't use barrels, it's because we don't have an angel's share. So we don't lose any of the product over time, so we don't have to make that much more of it to begin with to end up with what's in the bottle. We make exactly as much as we need. With that said, what I think is interesting is to think about the application of the technology outside of whiskey itself. You know, we have a couple of other things in the pipeline where you actually do get a much better sustainability advantages. Wine is a really interesting one where you're talking about a 30-fold reduction amount of water required, right? You're talking about massive amounts of pesticide reduction that also don't end up in the product because we don't have to remove it. We simply never add it, right? You're talking about no heavy metals in there. And so there's a lot of interesting advantages as the technology plays out, but I wouldn't tell any whiskey drinker that they should be worried about sort of how bad the whiskey is that they're drinking for the environment.
Oh, I'm not saying that, but as we face increased food demand, sure, with a growing population, that corn that we're growing out in the Midwest may be needed for food purposes at some point. Things like water that may need to be diverted for other purposes, forests that may need to be diverted for other purposes. I'm not saying the industry is environmentally bad. We know they've made a lot of strides, but at some point, everything catches up with us. And that's why I'm wondering about the sustainability issue for this down the road. Is 100 years from now, we may have no choice but to move to something like this. You mentioned wine. If I remember correctly, some of your initial experiments were with wine and didn't quite work out the way you thought, from what I understand.
Well, our very first prototype was a wine, and as with any new technology, whenever you start something, the very first version isn't quite ready. So, yes, that wasn't market ready. What I think was interesting, though, is when you show a new technology, there are people who aren't looking at what they see in front of them, but where it's going. And that, I think, was really the motivation that kept us going. So people saw, you turned this thing from water into this thing that is wine-like, it's wine-ish, in a few hours, and you just launched this, you know, you just started working on this 3 months ago. I'll give you a little bit more time to figure it out.
Fair enough.
And so that's where we are now, is at a place where we have a couple of things that are ready to go to market, hopefully over the summer. Now we're doing the labeling and the formulation thing. But the products from a taste perspective really are ready to go, and we're excited to get those to the market as well.
You have the basic Glyph expression out right now. When might we see more varieties of Glyph with, say, peatier or smokier or woodier varieties coming on the market?
Yeah, it's interesting. We could make those now if we wanted to, barring the new formulations and the labeling side. What we really want to do is to showcase, well, there's two things. We don't want to get pigeonholed into just being the whiskey company. Not that there's anything, you know, we love being a whiskey company, but we don't want just to be a technology that is for whiskey. And so what we want to do is we want to showcase how robust this is in the alcohol industry in general. And so we're actually just having a lot of fun playing with other things first, and eventually we'll come back to do more whiskeys too. But I think that people will be pretty excited for some of the things that are coming next.
Last question. You talked when we started about your grandfather making brandy with him back in Europe. What do you think he would say if you told him what you were doing now?
I think he would love it. I mean, he was organizing a lot of international trade of commodity resources. He was thinking about a lot of sustainability things, a lot of efficiency things, you know, which markets that you can get certain crops in the most efficient way from. And I think that while he always wanted to go back and to his orchard to make his brandy in his way, that there was always a piece of him that was one foot in each world. And that's how I feel too, right? That's really what Glyph is. There's a lot of what we do that is very respectful of the traditional way of doing things. I mean, ultimately, we've made not some random spirit, but something that is stylistically as close to a whiskey as we think, you know, it we wanted to design it. And so we're having fun towing the line too.
So, is Glyph whiskey? As you've heard, Alec Lee says yes, just a different style of whiskey. And the Treasury Department's Tax and Trade Bureau, the TTB, has ruled that Glyph does meet the legal standards to be called a spirit whiskey. The Bureau did not respond to our specific questions about the approval process for Glyph. It traditionally does not comment on specific licensees or products. I tasted Glyph, and while I'm not going to post specific tasting notes for Glyph on the WhiskyCast website, it has a lot in common with some of the flavored whiskies on the market. It's pretty sweet, and tastes more like a whiskey-based cocktail than a whiskey. And I'll leave it at that. Thanks to Alec Lee of Endless West for joining us on WhiskyCast In-Depth. It's brought to you by Mortlach, whiskey's best-kept secret, hidden for decades in some of the world's most famous Scotch whiskies. Now comes a single malt inspired by an original for a fortunate few. Discover the entire Mortlach lineup at malts.com. Let's start off the What I'm Tasting This Week department with Armorique's Triagos French single malt. This one is a lightly peated single malt created to celebrate distillery Waringem's 20th anniversary and is bottled at 46% ABV. The nose has hints of peat smoke along with a nice maltiness and touches of citrus fruits and vanilla. The taste starts off light and fruity with a citrusy tartness, while a nice balance of smokiness and spices takes some time to develop. There's a touch of grilled pineapple, along with vanilla and honey in the background. The finish is subtle and slightly tart, and I'm scoring the Armorique Triagos a 90. I had the chance the other night to taste the latest edition of Dad's Hat Pennsylvania Straight Rye during Whiskey Live in New York. It's now a 4-year-old rye bottled at 47.5% ABV. The nose has soft spices, along with rye bread and hints of honey and molasses. The taste is tart and peppery, with hints of dill, honey, and vanilla underneath, while the finish is long, spicy, and smooth. I'm scoring the Dad's Hat 4-year-old Pennsylvania Straight Rye a 92. Ireland's Powers Court Distillery is still maturing its own whiskey under the guidance of longtime master distiller Noel Sweeney, but has released a line of sourced whiskies under the Fercullen brand. The Fercullen Premium Blend is bottled at 40% ABV, and like the single malt and single grain, uses whiskies that Sweeney distilled when he worked at Ireland's Cooley Distillery. The nose is light, with gentle hints of citrus, vanilla, honey, and dried flowers. The taste is tart and fruity, with citrus, ginger, hints of spice, and a slightly flinty taste. And the finish is long and slightly tart, with a flinty touch in the background. I'm scoring the Fercullen Premium Blend an 87. I'm adding these tasting notes to our searchable list of nearly 2,600 different whiskies from all over the world. You can check it out at whiskeycast.com.
Redbreast fans have always cherished our whiskey's sherry notes, so we set out to embellish that character. Introducing the Redbreast Lestow Edition, a quintessential single pot still Irish whiskey finished in first fill Oloroso sherry casks from Spain's prestigious Bodegas Lestow. Carrying Redbreast's trademark pot still spices and dark dried fruit notes, the Lestow edition is graced with an enduring sherry finish that would be better described as a final act. Discover the newest branch on the Redbreast family tree.
Time to open up the inbox now for Your Voice, presented by Lot 40. Thanks to the folks at the Irish Whiskey Society in Dublin, I had the chance to meet up with some of them last week while I was in Dublin, and they gave me one of their 2-ounce whiskey glasses and a sample of one of their society bottlings to bring home. But they also tweeted this out after our last episode that featured a tour of Dingle Distillery. Great Whiskey Cast episode focusing on Dingle whiskey with a trip to the distillery, interviews, and stories with the Dingle team. A nice feature, especially for everyone who got to our Dingle whiskey tasting event last month. Enjoy! Thanks again, gang. Douglas Griffin at D. Griffin Chess tweeted this out. I wonder if WhiskyCast has heard of today's Lindoris Abbey event. Well, I had. The distillery hosted a chess tournament with 4 of the world's top chess grandmasters this weekend. But it's not easy to play chess and drink whiskey at the same time. And finally, congratulations to Simon Pagenaud, who swept the month of May at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway with his victory in today's Indianapolis 500. Now, Simon just happens to follow us on Twitter. And while I'm not saying that following us on Twitter had anything at all to do with his great month, well, it's just an example that it never hurts to follow us on social media. By the way, thanks again to everyone who's posted reviews and ratings over the last few weeks on Apple Podcasts, along with Google Podcasts and other podcast apps. That feedback does help other whiskey lovers discover the show when they're looking for new podcasts. So if you haven't done it yet, I hope you'll take a few minutes this week to leave a short review or rating for WhiskyCast on your favorite app. If you have anything else you'd like to share with whiskey lovers all over the world, you can always get in touch with us on Twitter, Facebook, or Instagram at WhiskyCast. Your Voice is presented by Lot 40, Canada's award-winning 100% pot still rye whiskey. Lot 40, unapologetically Canadian. Please drink responsibly. Let's wrap things up now with Behind the Label, our look at the history, science, and other things that make whiskey unique. It's brought to you by Writer's Tears. The other night, I was a guest on YouTube's Spirited Science with Scientist Mel, and one of the questions that came in on Twitter before the show came from Sean White at Sean White R. The question, why are hard spirits often called water, such as whiskey, eau de vie, vodka, aquavit, aquavite, or kirschwasser? Well, this one does cover more than whiskey, but there is a good answer for it. You have to keep in mind that the monks that brought the art of distilling spirits with them as they moved through Europe were producing spirits largely for medicinal use a few centuries ago. The monks weren't using barrels to age that stuff. That came along a few centuries later, and we know now that wood is what gives whiskey its color. Since the spirits those monks were distilling were as clear as water, it makes sense that they'd be given names in the local dialects that were based on water, such as uscaba or eau de vie. Aquavite, of course, is Latin for water of life, and since the monks would have been educated in Latin, that also figured into the discussion. If you have something you'd like us to look at on Behind the Label, just use the contact form at whiskeycast.com to get in touch with us. Behind the Label is brought to you by Writer's Tears.
Writer's Tears Copper Pot, a unique triple-distilled premium Irish whiskey, combining single malt and single pot still. First fashioned in the 1700s and still a rarity today. Sure, as we say in Ireland, what's rare is wonderful. Writer's Tears Copper Pot.
That's all for this episode of Whiskey Cast. You'll find links for the stories in this episode in our show notes at whiskeycast.com, and that's where you can also find links for our WhiskyCast Tasting Panel podcast and our WhiskyCast HD videos. You'll also find the latest whiskey news, my tasting notes, the whiskey photo of the week, and a complete archive of past WhiskyCast episodes all the way back to 2005. We'd love to hear from you. You can get in touch with us on Facebook, Twitter, or Instagram at WhiskyCast. The email address is comments@whiskycast.com.
From far beyond the wall comes a whiskey for those who face the oncoming storm and never stop walking. Winter is here. White Walker by Johnny Walker.
White Walker by Johnny Walker. Blended Scotch whiskey, 41.7% alcohol by volume. Imported by Diageo North America, Norwalk, Connecticut. Please drink responsibly.
Whiskey Cast. Brought to you by Redbreast. The definitive single pot still Irish whiskey. Those in the know Redbreast.
Whiskey Cast is a production of Cask Strength Media, copyright 2019, and comes to you from the charming, yet regrettably dry town of Haddonfield, New Jersey. I'm Mark Gillespie, reminding you that when you drink, please drink responsibly. Thanks for listening.